to order at 6:07. We're a little bit late with some housekeeping. First of all, we need to approve the minutes of the March 15th meeting.
Motion to accept the minutes of the March 15th meeting.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All right, tonight we have a sizable piece of our budget with Frontier and Whately Elementary School budgets. And luckily, we have people to speak to them. And why don't we start with Frontier first? And Marty, we don't expect you to go line by line.
Good.
Give us the cliff notes, give us the overview.
Yeah.
We'd like the increase for Whately.
Okay.
Okay. Well, we do have some things we'd like to discuss with you.
Okay. The basic thing is we have had two public hearings on the budget thus far, and the budgets have been voted and approved by the school committees. The increase for Frontier for Whately is 3.69%, but your assessment is negative 2.41%, which is what I'm sure you're referring to of what you'd like. The highs and the lows, and I'm looking at these budgets this year as maintenance budgets. Our goal was to not lay off people like we did last year. And we have, for the most part, been able to do that. We have consolidated a couple of positions of retiring teachers because we're constantly mindful of the enrollment, which is not skyrocketing down, but slowly decreasing. So that's, you know, I can go through the summary page or have Patty go through the summary page, or we're happy to answer questions too. I know some of you were at the public hearings and had a chance to ask some questions.
I think it'd be good for everyone if Patty touched on the summary page, and that way they, because you are the money person, so.
Okay, so if you go to page 5 of 29 on Frontier, last year our assessment to the towns was $9,747,730. And though we don't have a negotiated contract, we do have to pay the steps, and that totals $55,036. We're increasing our psychological services by 0.4 FTE, and that'll be a cost of $30,810. The reason we're doing this right now is that we've done a good job of keeping our kids in district and not in out of district, especially at the elementary level, and now those bubbles of sixth graders are going up to Frontier. So they need more help in the psychology department to handle these kids that are going to be now going into seventh grade and eighth grade in the next 2 years.
The other piece to that is last year when we had an adjustment counselor's position, she retired. We did not replace it for this year. So we wanted to do a wait and see. And frankly, we need a piece of it, but not the whole piece. So hence the 0.4.
We have two big changes of funding. School choice budget was $126,934 of salaries, and our tuition revolving was $38,496. What's happening with the school choice budget is for the first time we're upside down. We owe more money than we're taking in because of charter schools. So there is a summary that I prepared so that you can see that.
We talked about this at the public hearing. Basically, we still have 3-to-1 students coming in as students going out. There is a funding formula reimbursement. The state said that they were going to fill when charter and choice became popular. And the funding formula says that the first year that a student is chartered to another school, you get 100% reimbursement for the tuition of that one student. In the next 4 years, you get 25%, and that's supposedly to ease the school's burden of having fewer students. Problem is, the state is not fulfilling that end of the bargain, much like they don't fulfill the Frontier or the regional transportation reimbursement either. That's supposed to be 100%. So even though we have three students coming in to every one student going out, we have more dollars going out than we have coming in.
And that's primarily because we're taking in school choice, but what's going out is charter, and that's the cost. But that analysis is on page 17 of 29. So this year, our total revenue in will be $929,664, and our revenue out will be $999,452, or a difference of $69,788. So we have to pick up that tuition amount and assess it to the towns. And also, the people that were getting paid off the school choice budget have to come over onto our budget, and that's where that 126 comes in.
The other problem with school choice is that the funding formula has never changed. Since its inception, it's been $5,000.
Right.
And as budgets have grown over the years, and you have certain positions attached to school choice dollars, so those salaries increase through contract negotiations, et cetera, but that $5,000.
How many years are we talking about going back since school choice?
Oh, 25 years. Yeah, it hasn't changed at all.
Paper here? No. The recorder? Is the recorder? No. They're not yet.
I don't see Dominic.
How much does it cost us to educate a child?
For?
Oh, those numbers aren't out yet for 15. They're still working.
Typically 13, 12, 13,000.
So we're taking in 5 and putting out 13.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Correct.
No, you actually, the charter school.
No, charter. No, this is choice.
Yeah, choice.
Yeah.
What's the dialogue been with our representatives?
Fast and furious, and often. You know, I've spent a lot of time with our state legislators, giving them actual data because they wanted that. I think we have a friend in Senator Rosenberg, but I also think he has a lot of pressure in the eastern part of the state where there's tons of pressure to continue to lift the cap on the charter schools. And tomorrow I'm going to be meeting out in Mohawk. It's trying to form a coalition of rural schools to see if we can impact the funding formula, because it is unfairly placed on rural schools. So
how do we force him to draw a line in the sand to make a public statement about the problem?
I don't know.
That would be,
yeah.
I think that would be something that we would need to explore.
And I don't know how publicly he's saying it. These meetings that I've had have been with other Western Mass superintendents.
Right. But if the other superintendents got together.
Well, they have. We have all year. I mean, we have contacted Britton, spoke.
This guy works for us.
I know that.
And we should have him on our side. He should be advocating for what we need. Mm-hmm. And if he's not doing that, then that should be in the paper. And Tom Relihan, I wish you were here, but if you're not, please listen.
Dominic Foley now.
Tom has moved on.
What Tom?
He's still there, but he's doing another section.
So Dominic Foley is doing the education in town base.
Okay.
So page 19 to 29, you can see by town the kids that are leaving our district. It gives you a snapshot as to where they're going and which towns. You know, Conway sending 16 kids out, Deerfield sends 33, Sunderland sends 25, Whately sends 14. So we have 52 choice out, but we have 36 charter out. That costs us $656,794. So that's a big chunk.
How do the other schools fare relative to charter? Like when I look at, this is by town, so Northampton, let's say. So Northampton is losing, on this sheet, $40,000, is that?
Unless there's a sped increment.
Okay. South Hadley, 5?
Mm-hmm.
Hatfield 144.
Right. We've got 8. We take 18 kids in from Hatfield on school choice. Or 18 are going to Hatfield.
Going out.
Going out to school.
Leaving
choice.
Hatfield.
Leaving our town. Two are leaving from Conway.
Front
5 from
sending school. Okay.
You've got 6 kids from Whately going to Hatfield.
Okay.
It's almost even, though. The number coming in is almost equal to the number going out for Hatfield.
Coming in, most of our kids are coming from Greenfield and Gilmontague in the lead. That's on page 18, is who we, where they're coming from and what we bring in.
What's the attraction at Four Rivers School?
My honest opinion is that it was formed to be a parallel college prep program, which was not the reason that charters were created. The charters were created because they were supposed to offer something that the schools in the area could not offer, hence the Chinese immersion school or the performing arts school. Four Rivers School, I think, is an elitist charter school. I've heard people say it's like sending your kids to a private school without having to pay for it. There is nothing that they offer that we don't offer.
So is that perception or reality that you can know?
I think it's both. And I don't mean to be offensive to families who choose charter school. My angst and anger isn't directed toward charter schools. It's directed in the funding formula. But if you're going to form a charter school, form it for a reason that the original charter was founded for. If you're going to do hands-on experiential science learning, that's great, then do that. I can't do that at Frontier in that same capacity. But don't form a parallel school to siphon off, you know, parents who have means, because you have to have means to be able to understand the application process and transport your child to the school. So,
what's your prediction looking out on this issue? Is this, are they at capacity?
No.
No. So.
Yeah, they draw mostly though from Greenfield and Gilmontague, just as we do.
Fort Rivers
does, yeah.
The Chinese immersion, they're still adding grades.
They are still adding grades.
So then, Frontier can be predicted, this is going to continue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, we're on charter, and maybe it's been corrected, but my understanding is that in the regional agreement, there's no wording so that Whately doesn't help Deerfield pay for the charter expenses.
There's nothing in the regional agreement, so it gets assessed like everything else gets assessed. And so if you were to look at that page where you guys only send out 14 kids, but Deerfield sends out 33, you're paying for more than 14 kids, and they're paying for less than 30.
And how do we fix that?
We need to look at the regional agreement, and that's something that Marty and I have talked about, that possibly next year, when we're done with policies this year, and we're done doing all of the negotiations, that we get a group together and start talking about redoing the regional agreement, because not only is it silent to these issues, but it's also still silent to capital issues.
Mm-hmm.
It was created in the 50s, it's been dusted off once or twice, but it's not very practical for today's financial world.
Who would be part of that?
I think everybody. It would be school committee members, town select board members.
Finance.
And
I think you'd probably have somebody from the Massachusetts Association of Regional Schools. Usually they kind of help oversee it and guide the conversation.
So we would hire a consultant to help us go through the process.
Any comments about this? Any thoughts?
Just a quick question with that. Like some of the other things where all four towns have to agree to it,
mm-hmm.
which is we've been through these type of things before, and the winners want it and the losers don't, so it never happens.
Yeah.
It's still worth looking at.
Okay.
Yeah. It may be futile, but you know. I mean,
but to do nothing is.
Yeah.
I mean, you at least have to try.
Okay. Now, in terms of the doing something but doing nothing, okay. And I'm just curious as to, and I asked this question when we had the meeting up in Frontier. Are we doing anything proactively as a unit, as Frontier, to try to slow the loss or drive the value of the school so that kids will think twice before leaving and want to attend here?
We don't lose too many students from Frontier. when they start to go to choice and charter, it's often in the elementary grades. And it's not that they're doing something wrong or not doing something well.
Parental choice.
It is, a lot of it is parental choice and where a parent lives, especially for choice. Now, I still say, you know, we have 121, 129 people who choice in to Frontier. It is a very desirable school to choice in. And the ones who are going to charter school typically do so before they get to Frontier. So...
Okay, so we know that.
We have 341 students who are choicing into our district. K through 12. Compared to other districts around, we are a highly desirable district. We probably have one of the highest, I think, Pioneer, because they have a relationship with a tuition with Vermont or New Hampshire, has a few more, but we have one of the highest incoming. So it's also a function of demographics. Just our population in Franklin County is slowly. So I think it's just a bigger issue than Frontier.
So what about the conversation of choice in general? You know, it's out there, but, you know, do we have to hire more teachers because we got these 342?
No.
Do we, I mean, are we in that, are we at a good balance right now?
We are, because we're backfilling. Now, I will tell you that Deerfield did get themselves in a position a couple of years ago where they were finding that approximately 30% of their kids were choice, and so they did have a third section. So they're having to slowly look at that number every year. Do we have a third section just because of choice?
Does that, down the road, okay, so we back it down a little bit. Deerfield is saying, okay, we're having to hire an extra teacher for half amount of students or whatever it is, where it doesn't make sense. Is that going to start affecting Frontier because we have kids that are going to Deerfield
eventually? Yes.
So that's going to be...
I would say 5-6 years down the road, yes, it will.
Most of our kids that are school choice at Frontier come from the elementaries. They don't come to Frontier as a school choice. They've been in our system through the elementary schools.
So, I mean, there's a lot of balls up in the air here in trying to figure out what the best recipe is for school choice, budget requirements as far as giving the proper number of students per class, all these things. And it doesn't seem like it's ever ending, I don't have the answers. I'm preaching to the choir here, saying that this is a moving target.
It is a moving target, and I think it really has to come legislatively. And I said this at the public hearing. I remember very clearly in Frontier when Steve Kulik was invited to talk about school choice. He said it will never be on the docket in Boston. There is no school choice east of Worcester. It's not an issue. School choice is only a problem or a function or something we talk about in Western Mass and in the Cape.
Well, we're all fishing out of the same pond.
Right.
You know, there's just not enough kids to go around to support.
But see here, in Whately, you're almost in the opposite position from Deerfield, because we have to have one grade level of each, but yet you've only got 77 native children in that building. 34 of them.
But I guess that's going to that point that I'm saying there's all sorts of different things that need to be looked at. I mean, we have a bunch of these brand new elementary, I say brand new, but very new, very nice elementary schools, and not enough kids in town to support.
How many children were born last year, Mark? Two?
I can't remember. No, it was more than two. I think it was like eight.
Well, the year before that, it was only two.
Yeah, I mean, in one of your grades, you only have six children who live in Whately. You have more because they're all backfilled with school choice. Otherwise, you'd be starting to combine grades and have 1-2 in a class and 3-4, and some schools do that. So, but I do think it's a bigger issue. I think it has to do with, you know, amount of industry, the amount of affordable housing, the amount of all of that stuff.
Do you think I guess you do, because we have a considerable number of students wanting to go to Frontier.
Mm-hmm.
We'll say 150?
I think it was 129.
But do you feel that, you know, I hate to use this term, but I don't have any other use. Is it marketed effectively?
You know, for years I did radio ads, I did print ads, and I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all because it felt like I was stealing from our neighbors. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure that we got the results. Because when you look at the big picture, you know, I had the Gil Montague superintendent explain to me. He has a class of 20 kids, and the top 5 kids start to go to Four Rivers or Frontier. Well, then the next 15 kids start looking around going, well, what other choices can I have? Because it's skimming off the top. And so they're losing millions of dollars. How are they ever supposed to improve their school systems? I mean, we are all neighbors in this thing.
Well, we are, but there's an old saying, fair is not equal.
I know. But I do think, you know, I'm not so sure that all the money we spent on print and radio ads really resulted.
You don't think
so? I don't.
Well, plus, don't you hit this point of hiring to support what you're bringing in?
Well, I guess that was the question that I went to. I mean, there's a formula that's going to say we're going to backfill, and that's ideally what you want to do. You don't want to get to that where you're budgeting your operation on school choice and then turn around and having to hire, you know, 3 extra teachers because we have so many kids that want to choose.
Right, and frankly, you can advertise for 6 slots in 6 grades and have nobody apply except 8 people in 1 grade, and we have no control.
And your question previously, like if our average student cost is 12 and we're only bringing in 5, I don't like that comparison because it's not apples to apples, because regardless if we had those kids or not, the lights still need to be on, the heat still needs to be on. So I like to drill down that number to just the educational component and take all the overhead costs off. And then do a comparison, which I usually, we're still waiting for Desi to come out with the dean's numbers. And when they do, I will present that to school committee. And I show them the educational piece, you know, the overall, and then I drill it down to student, you know, educationally, what we would be spending for kids without the overhead on.
It's just that, you know, we don't really absorb these issues and changes until the budget season mm-hmm. comes around and hits you in the head mm-hmm. and you start looking into it. And I think there's a little bit of frustration now when I hear the principal of Frontier saying there's $1 million going out the door mm-hmm. and there's that kind of a loss. I know there's a formula. I know there's not a lot you can do about the formula. I think we need to put pressure on Kulik mm-hmm. and Rosenberg, and are those guys either going to stand behind us, or we got to make it public that they're not standing behind us, and maybe somebody will run against them that will. Mm-hmm. That's how our democracy works. But from what we can do, I think the frustrating part is that I don't get the sense that anybody's feeling that there's something else that can be done. And
I'm not sure exactly what you're asking.
Well, something, if you do what you've done, you're going to get what you got. And having what we have is not something that we can sustain. So
they are looking at the foundation budget. They have a foundation budget commission, and I attended the meeting, which they had an actual meeting, a hearing in Western Mass, and I went to it. It was, I forget when, but they were astounded listening to all the rural Franklin County towns, and there was a lot of select board members there. There were a lot of FinCon members talking about how this formula affects them, and their eyes were like popping out of their heads. Yeah, at the difference, because they don't ever think past Worcester. They don't understand the geographical location, the busing issues, and I think they really did try to take that into consideration. The two big things that they're looking at are SPED costs and how they fund the SPED, and the second one is the increment for teachers' health insurance, because that's just going through the roof as well. So they put out a report, but I don't think anything has been adopted yet. I think they've got to go now and have public hearings on their recommendations, but I will be following that and attending those public hearings as well.
The other piece too, this rural coalition that we're helping to create, it's based on a Wisconsin model. What we get right now is, we got an increase of $20 per student. That was our big increase for the state. And this would at least increase it to $50 a student to give us some sort of differential to make that up. So Kulik did say when we had a legislative meeting 2-3 weeks ago, he would be very interested in attending this meeting. He's sending a rep tomorrow and perhaps supporting some sort of legislation on this. Because I think, I really do, and I'm not trying to duck your question or anything else, Paul, but I think it's a bigger issue. I think there's only a certain amount, you can only take so many people that exist. And until my age group either dies off or moves to Florida or something, I know in Deerfield specifically, there's not a lot of housing turnover. You know, we're all still in our homes. So, so there's not a lot of availability for young families with children to move into.
Sure enough. Okay,
so going back to page 5. The largest increase we have is $276,749. That is for the 6.8% increase in health insurance that we are hit with this year. It also has money in there for contract settlement negotiation for both union and non-union staff. We are eliminating one English teacher, which will save us $63,065.
This is through attrition?
There's no layoffs. Right, no layoffs. This is all through attrition. And eliminating one instructional assistant, which will save $22,982. Now, we do have several retirements, and we're hoping that between what they leave at and what we bring in, we'll save another $63,237. So the total changes in our salary is an increase of 3.89% or $378,741. Other operational increase is the charter tuitions, that's that number I showed you, $69,788. Our sped tuitions will increase about $29.57. Our Franklin County assessment for retirement increased $15,354. For other increases of 0.9% or $88,099. Now, having one less English teacher and one less IA should save us about $15,504 in benefits. We're decreasing our legal fees by $8,500 because we do have an attorney on retainer now, and a decrease in the retirement costs, $83,450. And that brings it down to $107,454. Minus 1.10 for a net change of $359,386 or a 3.69% increase, which will bring the net operating budgets assessed to the towns to $10,107,116. Now, I do want to bring your attention to another page so I can explain why we have a decrease in retirement costs, and that would be page 20 of 29. That decrease you're seeing of the $83,000 was what we paid out in retirements last year. This year, we have $185,490 to pay. We also need to purchase a new student information system for $50,000, and we have to pay out the retirement costs of the superintendent because when we did our budget last year, Marty hadn't told us she was leaving. So these items would have been in the budget. And what the Frontier School Regional School Committee did was they have used the excess and deficiency fund to pay those. So the budget was reduced by those items. Because these items really, you know, especially the information system and the retirement to the superintendent, really are town cost, you know, should have been assessed between all 5 schools. So that would bring our excess and deficiency down to those three together cost $255,490, and that would leave us a balance of $203,226. and then they voted to use $100,000 to offset the assessments. So our excess and deficiency is sitting at 103,226. And as long as nothing happens, we will probably consider putting more money in our OPEB trust at the end of the year if our balance is still that, at the 103.
Well, we'd hate to see you go, Mike, but good luck and put your mark on this place.
Thank you.
While we're talking about superintendent, will we be saving any money in the change?
A little.
Yeah?
Yeah, a little.
So how did we wind up with a negative number?
Your assessment?
Yes.
Your enrollment. It was a change in your enrollment, and there, I believe you also had a decrease in your minimum contribution.
The formula.
And the formula decreased.
27, 29
has the your your local minimum contribution went down $3,687, and then your student's population went down to...
Well, the year you dropped was 92, and you replaced it with 60. So it was just the way your enrollment did.
What page is that on?
That is on page 27 of 29.
So that's the five-year enrollment
average.
So 2010 drops off, and you had 92 children going to Frontier at that time, and now you've only brought in 60 for 2050. So your percentage went down to 12.6%.
The last thing I really have to say is that, Patty, I think you do a good job of putting this budget together so we can really understand it. And there's not a lot of things that are hidden in there.
There's none.
Right. Well, not yet.
Not that he's found.
I think or that's, and I think it's great. I mean, you've got all the scenarios in there. And but the one thing that I see, but the school budget is a big part of our budget, and I'd like there to be no surprises. So this year, this is a great number for us, right? I mean, we really like it. Is there that five-year plan? Can we predict, going forward as to, geez, in 2020, we really look like this budget is going to, really just explode on us. I just want to make sure that we're managing the enrollment, we're managing all these things. I know it sounds like it's basic stuff, but if we're sitting here 3 years from now and we're looking at a 9.7% increase, I'm going to say, well, what are we doing here? What are we doing? So what is in place, if anything, that we can continue to forecast? I mean, there's always, in business, there's three-year plans, there's five-year plans, and then, sometimes they get executed, sometimes they don't. But this is a big one for us. Mm-hmm. And, I can't emphasize enough I'll speak for the group, is that this is important to us. And having you come in here and explain all these things is great. At the end of the day, the number is great for us this year. I just want to ensure that we're not sitting here, and then all of a sudden we get hit with something that we're really not expecting.
Well, there's two answers to that question. One, we go back to the original agreement and see if there's a better way to forecast the five-year rolling enrollment. Maybe there's a different, maybe other school districts out there are using something that is more predictable. And what would that be? Well, we would investigate that. And that would be, again, going back to the regional agreement and looking at different options for that piece. We can also use our NESDEC predictions and plug them into modeling and try and forecast that. The second piece of that is there's so much of it that's out of our control, and that is in the state legislature. The local minimum contribution, the way that I have no way to predict what the equalized value of the property in the town of Whately is going to be. They're still using 2013 income tax returns for Whately to do town wealth. I mean, it's 2016, let's at least up it to 2014. I don't know why it takes the DOR so long to compile these numbers. The equalized value changes every 2 years. I would think that we want to refresh our wealth, our community wealth numbers as well. And what percentage that they apply to each of those pieces is, you know, that's out of our control. So that piece, I can never forecast for you what the state legislature is going to do with that formula.
You know, the one thing that you did say was the formula that could change. And we talked, you know, Keith had mentioned that, you know, the people are making out want to support the people that aren't, mm-hmm. you know. If we could start to change that and start to realize, okay, in the future, in whether it's 2 years, 3 years, whatever the formula is, if we could plan for these things, instead of saying, oh, geez, here's our budget year, we're gonna have this huge increase. So maybe that's a way to sell it, is that we could actually, it's gonna be shared amongst the towns, but we're not gonna have these big waves if we can.
It might be more predictable.
You know, I mean, that's my only, I shouldn't say it's an issue, it's not. I think, you know, you lay everything out very well that can be understood, but the next piece I see is going forward as to how can we just become more predictable.
Well, and I think the other piece, you know, to that is talking about the four elementaries and how much more sustainable they are as individual town schools. And that could be a way also as leverage, because the bigger towns bear a bigger burden of their elementary rather than sharing. So that could be another leverage point with them. I know it's a difficult topic to talk about, regionalizing the elementary schools, because I know that they are community centers, they're the heart of every town. But from a financial standpoint, I think that if I didn't tell you as a financial model that they're not sustainable, then you should fire me for not bringing that to your attention.
Guys, you good? Anything you'd like to wrap up on the Frontier side, Mark? This is your last chance.
My last chance. I guess the one thing, having been principal there for 12 years, it was, I had intimate knowledge of the budget, and I know that the push was to maintain the programs, to continue with the AP courses, to provide the remedial services that we need for our special ed students, and to make it still a desirable place for people to come. And I think they've accomplished that, but I agree with what Patty said. You know, I will honestly tell you, if they lift the cap on charter schools, I think you're going to see the demise of public education as we know it. And I don't say that to be dramatic. I truly, truly believe that. It's going to be out of our control. And so I think people just need to continue to pay very, very close attention to it, especially in this particular area of the state.
Do you think school committees could do more to help out with the issues, to uncover whether or not there is more that could be done? Whately Elementary, that's not being done now?
Yeah, I think the next step, you know, I spent this whole year reviewing all of the policies because that hadn't been done, and that will be completed before I go. But the next step is to have this regional committee, and it's got to include people from all four towns and school committees to take a look at it. And also, as Patty said, these are really tough conversations to have. I served on the regional committee back with Rich Plimpton 30 years ago. And there was financial incentive from the state at that time to talk about regionalization. There's no financial incentive right now. But when you look at enrollments of Native population in your school in particular that have 6 and 7 students in it, those are hard questions. And are you going to always have those school choice slots filled? Are you going to always have those students available?
Probably not. You don't know. Nobody knows.
Nobody knows. I do think that is definitely the next step, to have a broader conversation and really ask some other questions.
But I do believe the MSA, the MASC, the Massachusetts Association of School Committees, they have a list as well. And I think that we do need to check in with them to make sure that they're representing our concerns as well as the eastern part of the state's concerns.
Off the subject, very quickly. When you look at, do you have software that allows you to look at an individual's budget within the school at any given time, what their spending is all the time?
It's not as accurate as I wish it were. We start doing requisitions and purchasing online. But I have a pretty good idea of where we are. I give monthly reports to the school committees every month at all five schools to let them know where I think we're in danger of overspending or where we might have some offset savings. But we had an issue over the past couple of weeks at the Whately Elementary. We've got a gas leak problem that's going to cost about $9,000. And we're going to keep our fingers crossed that we've got heating money left over to, because they're going to fix it over April vacation, but.
It's not in danger. I don't want the public out there to think that we were putting this in danger.
No.
It's
contained, but it needs it's been temporarily repaired, but the final repair will be done, the permanent repair, I should say, will be done in April vacation. But we thought this was going to be a $2,000 to $3,000 project, and now it's up to $9,000.
All righty. Well, thanks, Marty, on the Frontier side of this. Love that role. Whately Elementary School.
Oh, you don't have the job. Okay. Would you like us to go through the summary? Again, your increase is 2.23%. And there really are not initiatives. There's some changes in funding. Your total budget is $1,564,490.
No, that wouldn't be starting with her.
From the year before, and I'm gonna ask Patty just to go through and do the salary-related
costs. So we have, again, the collective bargaining agreement steps, which are $12,729. We have one teacher who changed, who earned a new degree, and that'll cost $660. We have longevity increase of $750. That's one teacher, one IA reaching the second step of the longevity, and a new IA achieving the first step of longevity. We have an increase in our per diem sub rate from $65 to $75, which will cost us $27.25. We are the lowest paying district for substitutes, and everyone's using ASOP, so our substitutes shop online, and they take the assignments that pay more, and we get...
What's more?
Some of them pay $85 a day, some of them pay...
We're having trouble getting subs.
So our subs, we're choking for subs because everyone's using this new online system, they can shop.
Yep.
We're changing the funding for the art and music teacher from school choice budget, putting it back on for $4,905. The early childhood teacher, $35,728. That part of her salary we used this year in the circuit breaker money that you so nicely gave us back. But we won't have that next year. We have two retirements, we have more than two, but we have our psychologist and our guidance counselor are both retiring this year, so we're merging the position, so we want the funding all to be on our town appropriation, so that'll be $13,895. There will be a decrease in two instructional assistants for $44,797. The reason we are down two is because one child will be going to the seventh grade, and another student with the IEP no longer requires a one-to-one. So we're hoping that those will be through attrition. And then we have anticipated savings replacing our first grade teacher of about $31,748. So our salary related, actually that should say decreases, we're down $5,153. And that's a typo. Other operational increases, central office, $3,847. That was due to the loss of grant funding for three positions, partial positions, our early childhood coordinator, the kindergarten grant, they tell us it's in, it's out, it's in, it's out, so we can't count on it for a salary, so we had to move that salary back onto the budget. And then the changes in the federal laws, the new EDGAR regulations for federal grants, if you don't work a certain percentage on the grant, we can no longer charge a partial salary. So we had to take two of our accounting salaries back on our budget. Increase in out-of-district tuitions, $27,000. That's in anticipation of a child going out of district. We're still waiting for the evaluation period to be over. Increase in instructional services, the garden program, $5,500. That was previously paid with a grant that we no longer can charge that. $554 for medical and health services. That's to cover the increase in the cost of EpiPens. And we now have AED machines in all the schools, but we never budgeted for batteries and pads that we have to replace every year. Increase in building maintenance and supplies, $4,000. That is to try to adjust us to what we're spending, and also we now need to incur an annual cost to have our roof inspected every year, so that we had to add that cost in there. And then again, we have our contingency in here for the piece of the insurance of the state office people, retirements and contract adjustments of $27,792. So that brings that budget up $68,693. School committee legal expense, we decreased by $1,000 because of our retainer. Overall, your central office percentage went down from 9.43 to 9.11, saving $6,072. Building heat, we think because of the past 3 years utilization, we've done an analysis, we can reduce that by $6,000. Sped transportation, we can decrease to $3,600, even if we do have that child go out of district. Our regular transportation, we have a five-year contract that allows for an annual COLA adjustment. This year it was a decrease instead of an increase, so we are saving $54.99. And we've decreased our textbook line, $4,905. And that's in relation to how we're moving more away from textbooks and more onto softwares and things like that. And then we have a decrease in sped instructional services of $1,500, which will decrease our budget $28,576 for a net change of $34,964 or 2.23%.
Any questions, comments? Dan?
Relatively new to this, but it's my understanding that we're now taking in the kids from the age of 3 and up into the school system.
We always have in preschool.
We always have.
Yeah.
And that there's a problem with their mental stability to some great degree.
If they're on an IEP, we're responsible for them until age 22.
Right. But yeah. My impression is that we're seeing like there's something in the water.
Well, that's, it has become problematic in our district as well as Franklin County as well as the state, that we are seeing a higher increase in behavioral incidents and emotional difficulties with 2 and 3 year olds. Some people say it's because we have better tools for diagnosis. Some people say because we're exposing toddlers and preschoolers to too much screen time and that their brain development is very different. We're also seeing an influx of children who are in private daycare and preschool being thrown out of those institutions.
Because
of behavioral and emotional needs, and if they're on an IEP or qualify or they're referred to us by REACH, then the schools are obligated.
And these are Whately residents?
Yes.
Yes.
They're Whately residents, they're Deerfield residents, they're Sunderland residents.
No, I understand, but right. Whately is paying for Whately.
Right, correct, right, correct. There is no school choice in preschool. So, yes, you are correct.
There is something we'd like to talk to you about, specific to, and you brought it up a short time ago. The CBA, the negotiated steps, in this case it was for instructional assistant, $750.
Longevity, yes.
Right. What we have is a situation where the school has given longevity pay to employees that are employees of the town.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, we have other town workers that want to be treated in the same manner.
Mm-hmm.
I got it. I mean, understand it.
Right.
But the issue to start with is that the school gave a bonus, a longevity bonus, to employees of the town. From my understanding, if it's a custodial worker, if it's if they're working in the cafeteria, if they're, those individuals are employees of the town.
As are your teachers and your IAs.
Okay. Who negotiate those things. These other individuals do not negotiate that. And what we're feeling is that the town is now going to have to follow suit with changes that the school makes in rewarding or paying individuals that work for us. And it's a domino effect throughout the entire town.
Well, let me just tell you, Paul, that the longevity thing is something that is very applicable to schools. And I will guarantee you there is not one school district that doesn't have longevity. And I will also bet you there's maybe half on the town side that do. Police, fire, they're separate entities. Even though we all work under the same umbrella of the town of Whately or the town of Agawam or the city of Holyoke, the city or town employees are separate entities because of ed reform, we have the right to do what we do. And my second point is also, and this was here long before Marty or I ever got here. This is something we inherited.
This
but
was,
it's
yeah,
very
the
common.
Policy was done in 1994.
The longevity policy was done in 19.
The personnel policy was originally done in 1994.
No, that's for contract or non-contract?
These are secretarials, non-contract.
Okay.
So that when the IAs became unionized about 4 years ago, they picked up the same language that was in there for the secretaries. Now, I will also tell you, if you're looking at the big picture, I understand what you're saying. It's generally very few employees who ever are entitled to this, because you have to be there for 10 years to get $250.
Right.
So it's never, the $750 that you saw, I think, is referring to one person or
three.
Two or three?
But three.
Three. So in my way of thinking, it's not a budget monster, and I'm not trying to be critical, but you know, in the big picture of things, it's a small bonus because our secretaries get what the teachers negotiate. If the teachers negotiate a 1% increase, then the IAs get it, or the secretaries get a 1% increase. So it's a way of kind of balancing things off.
Right, but you do that without any kind of input from the town as to what our economic position is.
Correct.
And I know it's not a budget buster here, okay?
Mm-hmm.
It's not a ton of money, I understand that. But that, as the, it's kind of like the tail wagging the dog.
Sort of, except if you look at it this way, the towns are under no obligation to give the same raise that our teachers negotiate. If you want to give your town employees a 2.5%, we've only negotiated a 1%. You know, that's your prerogative.
And the other thing is that it is the prerogative, it's the law of the school committee, since Ed Reform in 93, that the school committee can set those policies. The budget is theirs. If that's what they choose to do with the budget, that's their prerogative.
So is it the same situation in Deerfield?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, every town.
So all of Deerfield town employees?
We just adopted the same policies, yes. In all four towns, we adopted the same personnel policies, so they're all the same.
Right.
Whether a Deerfield employee gets it or not, I don't know.
So, Conway, Sunderland, town, highway department.
No, they probably don't know that.
I don't know. I have to be honest, Whately's the only one that's ever brought this up for discussion.
Well, to be honest, the reason it got brought up was because, you know, our town employees outside the school started asking for it.
Right.
And so that's, you know, other than that, you know, we don't know, it's your budget. I mean, we're not going to tell you line item by line item. I mean, we don't have the right to, as you've been saying, to you spend your budget. But when it starts to affect the rest of the town budget, then we started asking some questions.
Yeah, we had a four town administrator meeting on Thursday. I'd be curious. I don't know what the other towns do. Yeah. They have a longevity clause in their personnel policies. I have no idea.
I've never
maybe
seen it.
Maybe they'll be alerted to that now.
Yeah, we may become the most hated town in the four.
Maybe. Yeah. Well, I guess my position on it is that, you know, and I keep on using these words, equal and equitable, you know, and my point is not everything is fair. And so that was my point with this is, okay, that's given to the Whately school employees, but the town employees, okay, you know, we don't need to be doing it for everybody just because one group is doing it. But what it did do was open up the door a little bit, a crack in the door that says we're going to do this now. You know, it's not going to bust our budget either to do it, but we do open a door, and what is it going to do down the road? Last year we had a similar conversation to this, and it was, I'm trying to think of the, you know, to be competitive, I guess, was the word that you used at the time. You needed to be competitive to do that, and you know, I guess my point, I'm sitting here, is, you know, after 10 years, $250 is going to make it's going to make a competitive difference. I don't think so. So they've been here for 10 years. They're pretty comfortable. Are they going to go work for somebody else to get less benefits or whatever it is? But I'll somewhat disagree with it. That point of it. But you must understand that it has opened the door a bit, and that's why the conversation is now. It's an uncomfortable conversation because we have some great town employees too.
Right.
You know, and we like to take care of them, but we also have financial responsibilities to the budget and to the townspeople as well. And it's not a deal breaker, but that door being cracked open is a little uncomfortable.
Well, like we said, this has been in place since 1994, and I guess the budget's being a little bit more transparent didn't work in this case.
But again, if looking at your own town budgets, if you decide that your personnel have not seen, you know, a significant raise, I mean, you would not hear any argument from any of us if you chose to give them 3.5%.
Well, and we certainly understand.
Yeah, because that wouldn't come back on you.
Right.
You're right.
But then we'd have the same argument from our secretaries. Well, how come the highway department got 3.5% and we only got 1%? We'd be dealing with that same issue, and we deal with it by saying the schools are different than the town employees.
Right.
The schools are run under one set of laws, the towns run under another.
Yeah, but now they're, because of this issue, now they're starting to come together almost, in that the town employees, not anybody in the school, but the town employees now want the same benefits that the non-contract employees in the school have. Mm-hmm. So, it's the schools and it's the town, but because they're all getting paid from the same checkbook, there's coming together.
Do we have the same, I don't even know if we have the same holiday pay or vacation pay.
I do not know.
I don't have a clue.
Thanks for bringing that up.
Oh, sure.
Or, you know, vacation policy, I don't know.
Maybe you want to look at comp time too, you know?
Do you?
But, you know.
Well, it's just as Joe said, it's, the door is now open.
But you said it yourself, there's not always equal.
Right. And in this case, we have good town employees. I don't begrudge any of them for picking up a longevity pay. Absolutely not. The problem is that it sets a precedent for someone to come in here who has or knows a real good employee attorney. And employer attorney and knows the laws far better than anyone here does and starts demanding things that we're gonna have to end up paying for.
Would it be helpful to get information when we meet on Thursday with the other town administrators to see what the other towns are doing?
Sure.
I mean, I think, you know, Mark can certainly bring that back to you.
I was hoping we could unhinge ourselves from what we do, but apparently that's probably not gonna happen.
Well, especially if three of the other four towns already do it, which I don't know, but
I don't think they do.
You don't, okay, I don't know. That might be our thing for it or not.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Any other? Are you still? Are we done with the Whately Elementary School? We've got a 2.2. Okay, we're good. Dan.
Just a quick. This is the Conway's school committee. Just the other night, making the claim that their food is superior to ours. And I was just wondering if it was tongue in cheek or it was.
No, they believe that.
They believe it. So why is, how is that?
Because they just do.
Okay, well, and to a similar but separate subject, the amount of monies owed to Whately Elementary for unpaid lunches. Do you have a number on that?
It's low. What the school committee has to pay is the unpaid balances for lunches and the loss. We cannot have the school lunch fund by law be in a deficit, and our school lunch fund is always in the deficit.
So not just Whately,
all five schools. And so we
because
have to
the parents are not paying.
No. Because the cost of the providing better lunches
is more than they're paying.
And then if we raise the price, more people will start bringing their lunch. And so that's another thing after Marty leaves that we really need to have some serious conversations as how we're going to keep sustaining these lunch programs, because they're also not sustainable.
We are the market basket of the valley, so our school knows.
I know. Well, that's why we want
farm to table.
I did farm to table in Holyoke, believe it or not, and it was great. The kids loved it. We'd have baked potato day, and they had the bar out there.
And they actually have that as well.
Yeah.
Well, Marty, good luck.
Thank you.
Staying around or heading out?
Staying around.
Oh, boy. Good.
So I'm going to be watching all of you on TV next year.
Laughing.
She's going to run for selectman.
No, I'm not running for Hundreds of part-time things, but, you know,
good.
Well, I'll see you next year.
Well, good luck.
Thank you. Yeah,
that's right, Betty. Good job again, and thank you for coming in and clarifying some things.
Great. You guys have a good night.
Thanks.
Thank you for letting us come in.
See you.
Stay in order here, Dominic.
Score.
This is Dominic, the new Tom Hallahan.
Dominic, how you doing?
He's the old Dominic.
Yeah, the last time he was here, Tom was in doing all the things.
He's still there.
Good. He's a good man. We were just hoping you might capture some of the, I don't want to put words in your mouth, or on paper. Well, yes, I do, but if Mr. Cooler could give us a hand on this charter school thing.
Mm-hmm. Ann Rosenberg,
you know. It'd be nice if they get on this. because it looks like it's going the wrong way.
Yeah, sure thing.
The Frontier is down by over $900,000 because of charter schools and the inequities there. That's a problem.
Okay.
Okay.
Next.
What do we, next, we have the Housing Committee presentation.
I think I was supposed to bring these, if I was.
What is it?
One page. Actually, I'm Richard Milberg, I'm chair of the Housing Committee. Jim Kirkendale, of course, is on the committee. What we're asking for you all tonight is to take a look at, to hear the presentation, have any questions you may have, and at the end of the day, give your support for a request for town meeting to set up a housing trust. And before I get into what it is, I'd like to explain why we're asking the question, because a trust is fairly, is much more substantial than a committee. The Housing Committee was set up as an advisory body to advise the CPC and the Board of Selectmen. So as an advisory body, we basically just did things. We had no real authority, no power. It became clear fairly soon that about the only way that Whately could expend its CPC housing monies, and the Community Preservation Act requires that 10% of all such monies be spent for housing. So none of this has to do with any other budgeted items. There will be no money taken out of the elementary school food program. And what we're talking about is that kind of money. And oh, it took us maybe a year to figure out the only legal way to spend that money was to actually invest in new development. Paint up, fix up, small things just didn't work for a variety of legal reasons that I can get into if you want. Now you come to the point of, we want to build new housing. How do we do that? We have to have land. Most towns have land available, little pieces here, little pieces there, and they simply send out an RFP and somebody says, yes, I'd like to secure that land, and away you go. Whately doesn't really have any land available to give out for housing. So what the town would have to do is to purchase land and then reassign it or resell it to a housing developer. To purchase land, as everybody knows who's ever bought a house, time is of the essence. You need to move relatively quickly. And that's where we come into problems, because the town meeting form of government and using CPC monies means that to get anything done, you spend months and months waiting for different organizations to have their different meetings. And Jim and I actually had a meeting, two meetings, with a broker for a piece of property on State Street. And about all we could do is we could say, well, if we were to get authority to do this sometime in the next 6 months, would your seller have an interest in doing that? And the response both times was, well, give us an offer. We couldn't. So we searched around, and the Housing Trust Fund has the ability to buy and sell land. Now, if this were Cambridge or Boston, the Housing Trust Fund would do that on its own. We recognize that people here want to make sure that the money is expended appropriately and they want to know about it. So what we've done is we've said, how do we set up a trust that still mirrors to the extent possible the amount of authority that the house wanted, that the town wanted originally to provide to the Housing Authority, which was relatively limited to the Housing Committee. So what we did is we said, we want to be subject to an elected official, but we want to have that official body be able to meet periodically so that we can have relatively quick decision making. And of course, the obvious answer is have the Board of Selectmen approve whatever the Housing Trust Fund wanted to do. In order to give the housing, the Board of Selectmen, an appropriate knowledge of what we're hoping to do, what we said was, the Housing Trust Fund should have some limited amount of money to do its due diligence, to get, you know, appraisals and to take a look at perk tests and this and that. So in the trust document, the housing trust fund could expend up to $5,000 per project or $10,000 per year on its own hook. Anything north of that has to be approved by the board. So that's the reason why we wanted to set up a trust fund. Let me talk briefly about what it can do. Trust funds can buy and sell property, and they can enter into agreements with developers to develop the property for affordable housing. I wanted to make sure that everyone realizes that affordable housing is not very, very low income. For a family of two for low income, the affordable housing can be up to 50, the income for this family of two can be up to $52,650 per year. Moderate income could be up to $58,150 per year. So you're not talking about importing incredibly poor people from other parts of the county. We're talking about taking care of the people who are actually living in this community and trying to provide housing for them. It is a municipal agency. It complies with open meeting law. Its votes are all public. The Housing Trust's meetings are all public. They're agendized. It would be a five-member board. Under state law, one of the five members would have to be a member of the Board of Selectmen. We have talked to our attorney, and what she's crafted is the one of the members has to be a member of the Board of Selectmen, and one of the members has to be a member of the Community Preservation Committee. CPC was very interested, wanting to make sure that it had a handle on how these funds were being spent over and above what it was doing with the Board of Selectmen. So there are going to be at least two members of this five-member board that report, that are members of the Board of Selectmen and the Community Preservation Committee. I think I mentioned the most that can be expended without any prior approval, $5,000 per project, $10,000 per year. What are the safeguards? Well, let me kind of list the safeguards in order of immediacy and power. The most immediate safeguard, as I just mentioned, is that two of the five members are members of the Board of Selectmen and CPC. And let me focus on the Board of Selectmen because they're the elected representatives. So if the Housing Trust Fund Board of Directors is going a little sideways, there's a person right there who's an elected official. And this person gets to say, gee whiz, guys, I'm not sure this would ever fly. So let's be careful what we do. So that's the first kind of break. The second break, of course, is that the Board of Selectmen has to approve everything for $5,000 or $10,000 per year. We talked about that. The third break is that the CPC will be providing annual appropriations of their 10% housing fund. So every year, the housing board will have to go to the town meeting. Well, first of all, we'll have to go to the CPC and say, you now have another $32,000, will you appropriate it to us? And the CPC then gets to go to town meeting and says, do you want to have us appropriate this? So that's, if there's any issue, and it's not a deal breaker, it's just this, the board is going this way, maybe the town wants to go this way. At that town meeting, you say, we don't want to appropriate any additional money this year. And then finally, town meeting can dissolve the housing trust. And if it does dissolve the trust, then all of the money goes back to the original sourcing entity, which would probably be the CPC. One advantage of the housing trust is that it can generate money exterior to CPC monies. So in case anyone wants to donate any money for housing, if there is a grant that we could go and get that we would not otherwise be able to get because there were no dedicated vehicle to provide housing, the Housing Trust Fund could go after that grant money or could go after that request. So what we've tried to do is we've tried to solve the one problem we came up against, which is time is of the essence and we ran out of time. And we try to do that as benignly as possible with the intention to keep the relationship between the housing entity, whatever it's called, and the town meeting as close as possible, the way that it was intended when the housing committee was set up, with the one proviso, of course, that the trust fund would now have the authority, subject to the Board of Selectmen to act quickly. I'd love to take any questions. Jim obviously is.
Can you tell me, what's the benefit to Whately to have affordable housing?
What's the benefit? Well,
other than, you know, it could service some people who live in town and or want to be in, you know.
Well, let's answer that kind of a push-pull. The push is that there is money backing up in the CPC fund that can only be spent on housing. And at some point, that money just keeps getting bigger and bigger. You may be aware that there's a state law that says 10% of all housing in every municipal entity in the state of Massachusetts has to be restricted, legally restricted, to low and moderate income persons and families. And by that I don't mean if somebody is living in a house and they don't make much money, that counts. It doesn't. It has to be an enforceable deed restriction on the property. So I think Whately has two units of affordable housing. So obviously we're nowhere near the 10%. Is the 10% real? Maybe yes, maybe no. Talk to Sunderland, they have that whole issue with this guy who said, you don't have the 10%. I can build this large apartment building by going through 40B because you haven't gotten 10%. So that's not a threat, I don't think, but it's kind of there in the back. So what's the advantage? Well, not everybody makes, north of $58,650 per year. There are a lot of middling and lower middling income jobs, people who are working in Northampton, people who are working in Greenfield. They live here. Maybe there are retired people who have these huge old houses. Their income is way below what it would be otherwise. They certainly don't look poor because they've got the house and they've got whatever they have. But the house is kind of starting to eat them alive because this is falling and that's falling. They don't need three bedrooms. What they really want is sort of a small apartment. Where are they going to get that? They're either going to live in that house and do whatever they have to do to get by, or they're going to move to some place that has smaller units.
So how does that work? I mean, is it a lottery? Is it, how do you identify who gets it and who doesn't?
Okay, it would be a lottery. It would be so. Well, let me back up for a second, because you asked kind of an important question. How does this whole thing work? There's a piece of property. The town owns the piece of property. The town goes out for a request for proposal, RFP, to the development community and says, gee whiz, guys, we want to see who's going to give us the most money for this piece of property building. And developer X comes in and says, I'll do it. It's a 20-unit development. And I'll get back to it in a second. I went to a meeting about a year ago on small town development, and every discussion was 10 to 20 units. And somebody in the audience raised their hand and said, well, what about a town that can only afford one or two units? Well, we don't deal with it. Goodbye. So you have a 20-unit development. The developer has to provide a lottery. And the lottery will be approved by the state or by, I'm not sure whether it's the state or the local COG, Council of Governments. They keep a list of people. Well, let's look at the Smikes House, which is just next to the old city hall, town hall. That is a two-unit development that happens to be owned by the town of Whately. And the town has entered into 10-year rolling agreements with Franklin County COG to manage it. So what happens is when somebody moves out of that unit, the Franklin County COG then goes down their list and says, would you like to live at Whately in this apartment for X amount of money? And the first person who says yes gets it. Now, let's talk specifically how this would work. We would send out an RFP because that's what the state law requires us to do. My guess is that there would be one, possibly two respondents. The obvious respondent is Habitat for Humanity, because they do onesies and twosies, and they will act, they have a program where they lend money to the family at 0% interest for 30 years. And so, and plus the family puts sweat equity into the project. So some number of people would respond, and my guess is one of them would be Habitat for Humanity. The Housing Trust Board of Directors would review all the responses, however many there were, and would say, we would like to enter into an agreement with this person, this entity. That agreement would obviously be not through the that would be approved by the Board of Selectmen. Then that entity would be responsible for all of the paperwork involving, you know, who's affordable, who's not, you know, how long do they stay on, what's the waiting list. That would not be Whately's responsibility.
And we would donate the land.
Not sure. We would. How do I say this correctly? We would receive the highest value for the land that is commensurate with getting a low and moderate income family into a house that is decent, safe, and sanitary. DS&S, decent, safe, and sanitary just means, you know, you've got a bathroom that works. There are minimums. But there's also something else. A long time ago, I was involved in a housing project, an apartment. And the feds were helping to fund it. They didn't fund balconies. The city I was working for didn't want this 30-unit building without balconies. So the city actually paid to have balconies put onto these units and patios on these units. So decent, safe, and sanitary does not include balconies. But if you have a decent, safe, and sanitary unit, and it is affordable to a person and family of low or moderate income, then there's a difference between that and the price of the land should be what the town receives. And there's something called a pro forma analysis. And the town would either hire somebody to review that, or the town, you know, could do it itself. And the pro forma analysis would, at the end of the day, you'd get to the bottom line, and the bottom line would say, this developer can afford to pay X dollars for the land.
Could be zero.
Could be 100, it could be 3,000, it could be whatever that analysis shows.
Members of the trust are the ones that do all the checking and all this. I mean, not the work and going, but, you know, they oversee all these. There's rules, well, there's regulations, there's all that stuff. And
we're very simple. Now, if this were, again, if this were Cambridge, the trust would have staff. The trust members, whoever they are, would do the same kind of due diligence that the Board of Selectmen would do if the Board of Selectmen decided to take this on themselves and they wanted to be in charge of spending some money. I think this would be something, if it were a Habitat for Humanity deal, if it were one unit, it's probably something. I think there would be enough horsepower on the board to review that and to come up with recommendations that make sense. If for some extraordinary reason there were a piece of land that could support a 10-unit development, that would be big enough that there would be money in there for staff, and then a consultant would be hired. A consultant would do all that.
And again, you would hire the consultant, or not you, but the trust would hire, I mean, who, I guess I'm just trying to figure out who's managing this whole business.
The trust would hire, but recall what the trust would say, it would go to the Board of Selectmen. And I would say, we have this. We've reviewed the resumes of three financial analysts. We believe, you know, Ms. Smith is the best one.
Okay, so I guess what I'm just saying is the legwork and everything.
The legwork would be the trust.
And does town meeting have a check on if it's greater than, say, one or two units? I mean, 20 units in Whately doesn't sound right.
No, 20 units in Whately isn't right, because there's no sewer. I mean, there's no. I think, I mean, that's not in the current document. But the current document says the Board of Selectmen have to approve this. So we would actually, they're the elected representatives, so it would be up to them to say, gee whiz, this is so important, we need to take this to town meeting, or they could say, you know, we think this doesn't make any difference.
So does the town ever take possession of property throughout this process?
Could or couldn't, doesn't have to. And that has to do with, how you want to structure the transaction. So it doesn't have to. So the land could be purchased by the housing trust and sold by the trust to a private developer. If you wanted the transaction, and I've been involved in transactions where you needed to get some grant, and the grant needed to be to go to a city or to a town. I was in cities. But so all of a sudden, the entity that did this in the state I used to work in, it was called Redevelopment, the agency would secure the land. It would immediately sell it to the city. The city would sign a document saying, we own it, we want some money. When the money came in, the city would sell it back to the agency. So that's it. The simple answer is it doesn't have to.
Okay. At the end of the day, what do you see as being the most amount of money that we're probably going to shell out in any 1 year?
Well, let's back up a little bit. The most
if
money is
one. Well,
okay.
Is it 10 grand? So you guys are looking for 10 grand?
Yeah, that's what I want to know. What are they looking for?
Okay, it could be. You know, I actually forget what the final number was.
86,000.
Remember, we've been getting housing money now, about 13,000 or 14,000 a year.
Okay.
You take a look at a piece of property. The piece of property, Jim, you and I were looking at was like 100 grand or 100.
It was less than that.
Was it less than that? 80.
I think it was 80 grand at the time.
Okay. So we're talking about buying land.
Yep.
And what I wanted to say for the answer was that the fund augments about 13,000 to 15,000 per year. If you want to do one transaction, you're probably looking around 100 grand when you get past due diligence, you know, thising and thatting, and then actually buying the land. So what's happening is that every year, the CPC would recommend to the town meeting that it put money into the trust, and the trust would say thank you very much. And when the trust got to a certain amount that it could actually afford to do something, it would then do something,
okay,
subject to the board of selectmen.
So it's like the money's in escrow, waiting
for
the green light from the town.
The green light from the Board of Selectmen.
Board of Selectmen.
Yeah. And that's the whole reason for this ownership, this whole business, is that waiting for the green light from the town means also waiting for the green light for each specific issue for the CPC.
Right. Yeah, right.
I've sort of beat that horse to death, Adam.
I got you now. Any questions? Any thoughts? Okay. So, is this in any way, shape, or form going to be something we need to vote on, to recommend, or is this going to be in front of the town?
The annual town meeting or?
Yeah, the town meeting.
Okay. All righty. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Richard.
Nice job.
Okay. Budget updates. Mark, is anyone here that's going to? Do you have anybody else that wants to?
Will there be a vote on the finalization of the budget tonight?
Perhaps
that. What's that?
You're going to say yes, and we're saying no.
Mm-hmm. On the whole budget?
On the whole budget?
Well,
I mean, so
we need to schedule another meeting if we don't. Yeah. So, which is fine. We can do that.
Yeah, I think so. I don't know the number.
Where's the number? You're going to.
Well, we got to digest it.
So your next meeting right now though is April 5th. So we need to talk dates before we leave them and schedule another meeting.
Okay.
Budget updates, real quickly. You all have packets of updates in front of you.
Yep.
I'll save the two remaining ones for Dan and Bob for next week. I'm going to just move on now, since you have those, to the budget draft overview. So you can flip to page 3. You're going to see an updated budget. Updated budget sheet. This includes the enterprise fund budget's been added. The far right column there separates town ops from the enterprise fund. And this is pages 3 through 5B now. Short and long-term debt has been updated, which is page 5. Stabilization and free cash totals on page 5A at the bottom on the left hand column there, you'll see our stabilization, capital stabilization, ambulance, and free cash balance. That free cash balance that you see at the bottom there, 531,192.76, is after our most recent special town meeting on the 14th.
So that's a good number.
Yep. Page 5B, just flip to the next page, you'll see an expenditure summary has been added, and you can see FY16 compared to FY17. Revenues have been added. There's a revenue summary just under that. And then finally on this page at the bottom, you'll see a tax rate estimate. $15.49, and I just want to be clear that this tax rate estimate is based on fully funding the capital plan, because I'm going to make changes after you guys do some voting tonight. It's based on fully funding the capital plan as recommended by the capital committee, and it's based on the recommendations from the personnel committee, the COLA, the longevity, and it's also based on submissions from your departments. So I guess now what we need to do is move into voting on some of these items, capital, COLA, and longevity, most importantly.
So we already did.
You didn't, you haven't voted.
We discussed it.
We discussed it.
All right.
It's a good thing no one else stayed home.
So capital, if you want to flip to, okay. I did also give you tonight updated capital spreadsheets.
6.
Yep, page 6, 7, and 8, I believe. The only updates I did to this were to remove the highway electrical, since that was deferred to the special town meeting, so that's been subtracted from the capital plan this year. And I removed the gym scoreboard for Whately Elementary School. And finally, I have updated the library request to $15,500 after last week's presentation. So I'm not sure where you want to start. Whether you want to start at the top with the highway truck and go,
yep,
go through them individually. But what I need to do is make amendments to this budget and have you guys vote on it so that I can get it on the I need to put it on the warrant and bring back to you guys for review of the annual town meeting warrant, which we have to do by the 5th. So we need to act quickly now.
Okay.
Hopefully you interviewed all the departments you needed to.
Now, did the schools just indicated that contracts have not been finalized? So, really, they have not.
Budget bargaining?
Yeah.
Agreements?
Right.
Correct.
So, those budgets are really still up in the air.
Well, they've budgeted.
They put a number in.
Yeah, they put a number in, but it's not in stone. So how do they get around that? How do we
that
get around
that? Could drag on for months, but
yeah,
they've included estimates in their in their budgets, so I'm assuming they feel comfortable with these numbers.
Okay. So that 1549, that includes those estimates?
Yes.
Okay. I'm ready.
They indicated the school budget was agreed upon but not ratified.
Yeah.
Which I'm guessing is the goal.
We asked the committees and departments to add their actual expenditures, which you have given us, which we haven't had a chance to look at.
Right.
Do we still want to look at it? I mean, I would think we'd still want to look at it before we vote on anything. And if so, when's the next that this committee could meet to vote on these items?
Well, you have to have it posted by April 5th. Is that?
Your next meeting is April 5th, and my plan is to bring the final draft annual town meeting warrant, which includes the budget, to you that night. And then the select board, since it's their warrant, will sign it. We'll review it and vote on each of the articles also, and sign it on the 12th. Actually, that date's up for debate right now. It's either the 11th, 12th, or 13th.
So that's your drop dead. Those are your drop dead dates.
Yes.
You got to have something put together by that.
Yes, and it will take me time to put that together. So I.
Really?
Those aren't your dates, those are my dates.
So my question is, could we meet next Tuesday and still, Mark, you have time to put everyone together for April 5th, which is the following week?
Is the, I think Jim, is it, can answer Jim's question for me.
Can we meet next Tuesday?
A better question, should we meet next Tuesday?
Tuesday is the 29th, the selectmen's meeting day.
And Wednesday's a public skims hearing?
Yeah,
Wednesday's a skims meeting.
I have a conflict on Monday night. Thursday night.
You want to meet for an hour? Can we meet for an hour before the selectmen's meeting?
Right.
How long is it going to take? Let's, you know, get through the bulk of it tonight.
But Tuesday night, it does not work?
No.
For you?
No,
for the select board.
Oh, for you?
Seven.
Oh, select board.
Okay. So unless you want to meet at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, it depends on how long you think you need to get through the budget.
Well, I think to make everybody, you know, and we had this discussion last week and some emails this week and everything. I mean, I think that make everybody feel comfortable about it. I don't think it's going to take a lot of time.
No.
But I think it would make sense to have everybody take a look at those numbers. And, if we, I also think it would make sense to schedule just before the selectmen's meeting. And if it, I wouldn't think that it would take us any more than an hour.
Well, if we can tackle capital, COLA and longevity tonight, those are the things that really take a lot of work because those numbers change everything.
Right.
So,
did we get 100% compliance on the budgets that did not have expenditures?
We're waiting on a few right now, but I gave you
got a lot of
almost
time.
All of them. I think we're waiting on three.
And
the three that we're waiting for probably total $1,500 for the three of them. I mean, it's not.
That's not a big deal. Yeah. It's just that, you know, when it comes to software that we have, do we possess software that allows us to look at an individual's budget at any point in time to see what they're spending against the budget?
Yeah. Each department gets
so much. So why are these? Why can't they put down their expenses? When the sheets go.
We don't have a line item.
We don't
yet. Let me just show you.
Okay.
We don't have a line item budget. So it's not, so they're not going to get a breakdown of this is how much you spend on salaries, this is how much you spend on office supplies.
But you do it.
Yeah.
But
when I do my, I have to sit down and do my whole breakdown, but what I get on a month, you're talking the software, will just have, like, winter roads. You'll have that balance at any time you want. But within that, some of that is payroll, some of that sand, salt, and things like that. You don't get that unless I have to physically break that all out. Because we're not a line item budget. If we had line item budget, then every single piece would all be individual, basically little budgets. And if I overspent, or if I needed to buy an extra plow blade, and I was over in that line item, I wouldn't be able to do it. Whereas in the winter roads account, if I need to wiggle things a little bit, I have that. That's why you don't really have a line item.
That's right.
But I still know what you, I mean, we still know what you spend at the end of the year.
Right, so now I want to take my garage maintenance account. You have no clue how much I spent on electricity. So when I put my budget together and I ask for X amount of dollars for electricity, I'm basing that on what I spent last year, and that's why I did the expense report on that. I have to be the one that physically breaks that out. No one else can give you that without me doing it.
You could have, say, my treasurer collector budget. I could have 100 items listed under my treasurer collector budget, but all it is a list. So when we do the breakdown, we have to take and add up all the things that were office supplies, and then we have to go through all those 100 items and find all the things that are.
So you don't have a way to summarize it. You don't have.
Okay, no, you have to do it manually.
If he had winter roads, okay, I could care less how many times he bought salt and how much overtime it was and all this other stuff. We don't have a way to summarize the report.
Right.
We know the bottom line.
Yeah. No, but I guess summarizing a.
You're going to have that more accurately. What you're asking for would be to have like a line item budget.
No, not necessarily. I mean, you can have a budget, and when you say line item, you're saying this is what it is. You can't spend any more than what this is
on plow blades.
Right. I don't really care what it is, what you're spending it on, but to have an idea whether how close you are to spending your budget. Are you over on this one? Are you typically under? On this one, where are you tracking it? I don't care how much you've spent, how many
no
different
way
times.
Of tracking that.
If you did have the software was able to summarize all these expenses, these 100 purchases that you made, and summarize them, and said, I've spent $25,000 out of a $30,000 budget.
Yeah, that we get.
That you get. Yeah. You get the bottom line.
Not based on a line item.
There's no way you're gonna get that without.
I'm sure most of you have heard of QuickBooks. I mean, QuickBooks could easily do that, and that's not very expensive software.
QuickBooks is nowhere near capable of handling the complexities of the accounts.
Yeah, there's probably other
complexities. We have Fundware, which
that
is...
That complexity QuickBooks can easily handle.
We so have Fundware, which we don't pay for. We don't pay for Fundware. It comes with our town accountant. So we don't even pay for it. We pay a small maintenance each year. I don't know, $500 or something like that, $750 of maintenance for our software. Right now, because we have the Franklin Regional Council of Governments as our accountant, it comes with that.
It's
their software package.
I mean, the other thing you're not gonna get is you're not gonna, we're talking about this thing, depending on when we're looking at it, it's not going to be, this fiscal year. I mean, we're talking about it now. I mean, we still have 3 months left to deal with it. So you can't look at the full picture. I mean, maybe the winter roads is okay. We know what that one is. But the electricity is going to, he still has 3 more months on the electricity to spend.
We don't want to get down into the weeds of everybody's budget. It's not what we want to do. What we want to be able to do is tell people on town floor that we saw what they spent, we heard why they need what they want, and we're saying yes, and we're recommending, we're saying either yes or no. The problem we had is that when you look at the budgets, and Jim did all the math on it, we had $58,000 worth of requests with nothing.
No backup.
No backup. And not a lot of lines. Like some departments had 3 line items. Some had 5. Some had 2. but nothing from the last 3, 4, 5 years.
No, I'm not arguing with you. I just wanted to explain how our system is.
I appreciate
is.
That, but somehow
and
we're going to get together
do,
here.
This system will allow you to do the subcategories within a budget, but we've never had it set up that way because it hasn't been requested in the past. So, I mean, if that's something that...
So it will let you do the subcategories.
It will, yeah. But it was never set up yeah. that way.
You know, we have the larger budgets like Keith's budget and, you know, the police budget there, those are there. But some of the smaller ones, by themselves, no big deal. But when you add them all up and you're starting pushing $60,000 in a year for just because I like you, you know, I mean, you can't do that. You know,
the reason I raise the question is because in Mark's cover letter requesting budget information for all you folks, he says, as in the past years, it is important to fill in the FY15 expenditure column of your budget sheet. If you would like your budget sheet electronically, let me know. So if saying as in past years, I assume that this is available in the past and should be available again this year.
It's so. Been requested every year, but there are those smaller budgets that...
Yeah.
The bigger budgets usually get done. It's the smaller ones.
But like we've been talking about this whole thing, it's you know, it's the smaller ones. I mean, the longevity's not going to kill us, but all of a sudden, you get $60,000 out there. That's, you know, how come?
Right.
That's why the question was asked.
Yeah. And it's,
can we not bring those people in? Well, are we having the discussion?
They've been given updates.
Oh, yeah.
So they asked for it last week. Department heads did the updates and they haven't.
So we got those updates tonight.
Right, and those are the updates we haven't seen yet. So let's be comfortable with that. And then, but you're right, we can certainly address some of the same stuff. You guys good with that?
Yeah. So back to page 6.
Okay.
Go through these capital items.
Capital items for FY17. Dump, first one right off the top, dump truck replacement. We replaced the vehicle FY2000. 145. Keith, is that still the number?
Gonna try to hold to it.
Any thoughts?
Yeah, we've discussed it.
We beat it to death.
We beat it into the ground.
What's the procedure? Just the move to approve it? Each line item? Or what's the procedure?
So we need...
You're not going to get it from me. Because I'm not in favor of it, so you're not going to get it from me.
Somebody should...
I make a motion that...
That's what we need.
A second.
That we accept the... for the capital... request of $145,000 to replace the 2000 dump truck.
And Jim, you did the second?
I second.
Okay. All those in favor, indicate by raising your hand. All those opposed? Okay. Motion carries. Paving of highway lot to salt shed. $13,000.
I make a motion we appropriate or spend the $13,000 to pave the highway lot to the salt shed.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay, Bob.
Do you want to?
Am I saying that right?
Yeah, no, it's fine. I was just wondering if you want to. Are there any in here that you want to
challenge?
Like, yeah. Because you can, if you want to approve the ones you want to approve all in one motion.
I got one question. The fire department exhaust thing, 47,989. I thought when John was in here, he talked about reducing that considerably.
Right, exactly. We talked about that quickly. I've got some more information on that. And for work, you know, I'm certainly not going to spec out his.
No, but I don't want to appropriate.
But that number is absolutely huge compared to other options, and he had spoke about the one that was in Hatfield. I also found out that there's a new one, fairly new within the last year in Wendell. I mean, there's other places around there that would, you know, knock $15,000, $20,000 off of that number.
Yeah.
So I was going to say the same thing. I'm a little, I mean, if that's one that we can save for next week's meeting to have him, I know it's going to screw up your.
Table that, maybe he can clarify that for you sometime this week.
Okay.
But if he's looking for, maybe you want to make a note of this, but, you know, the company that he was talking about, I don't know if he made mention of it, it's called Airbag 911. And he can get, he'll be able to get a quote from them, a rough quote from them, you know, and just to get a number to compare it within, you know, 24 to 48 hours. But I think that, I'm pretty sure that's what he was looking at.
Are there any other items?
That's the only one that's stood out to me. Now, if you want to just, I make a motion, we approve paving and building repairs for the police department, $10,000, $35,000 to replace the 2009 cruiser. The library, $15,500 for ramp roof and entrance improvements. Rec commission, $3,000 for the maintenance shed at the Blue School, $6,000 for the padding at the Whately Elementary. That's it, right?
I'll second that.
Anybody contest any of these? Elaine? Any questions? Okay. So we're replacing the 2009 Cruiser, $35K. Is that the top end on that?
Price wise?
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that a Prius?
No.
Sorry, Paul.
I
tried.
I got better color.
He volunteered to give me a test car, though.
I agree.
He did mention that.
He's a great guy. All right. Okay. Got to vote. All those in favor? Can it pass?
All right.
Okay.
Capital.
No, Enterprise.
Water
Enterprise.
Yep.
$10,000 for the generator in the pumphouse. $5,000 for a truck replacement. And $15,000 to clean and waterproof the tank. I make a motion we accept those expenditures.
A second.
Just one thing. I mean, do we ever? I guess. I mean, we still haven't had the conversation on who pays for this stuff at the end of the day. So
no, that would be paid for.
This is enterprise fund
this
stuff.
This is enterprise.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
This
I'm
is
sorry.
Definitely. Yeah. Okay. This is not a borrow. Okay.
This isn't the.
This is the one.
My guess is that they will fund those out of retained earnings and the balance in that account after the last special town meeting is $50,500.
So is there a motion made?
Motion is made.
And seconded.
Who's seconded? All those in favor on the enterprise fund? We're good.
That's it, right?
So I'll have John come back at the next meeting whenever we set a date.
He can come back on next week if he can. So you're good with that number, right?
Yeah, I have everything lined out here. So, Colas.
Colas.
Good.
So the personnel committee has recommended a 2% COLA. The total of that, the estimated total on that, if every dollar of salaries is expended in FY17 would be $11,841.
I mean, couldn't you remember how much?
$11,841.
And that's it? That's in the tax rate?
Yes, and that would be, again, worst case scenario. That's every dollar of every salary line spent.
Okay. Motion?
I make a motion we approve the 2% COLA.
Second.
All those in favor?
Is that 5-0?
Yeah.
Longevity.
Children is a meeting that's going to go to about this, about the COLA, about the
that's not going to, that's
not going to change it.
No, that's not going to change it. That was just meaning that she's going to attend the other schools to find out if
other towns are
matching. Right, right. That's
at this point. Difference.
It's not going to make a difference on what we do at this point.
What's the total impact on that?
1750.
1750.
That's, it's not going to be that much now. Because.
Oh, no, we did have after the, if the, the policy.
One person retired.
Right, so the policy, with the policy adjustment, it'd be 1500 then? I have to go through the budgets and add it.
Okay, so $1,500,
roughly.
Okay, for longevity.
And we did it last year.
And we did it last year.
So now we've made the precedent.
Yeah.
Setting.
Yeah.
We're going to.
Yeah, that's what we're going to.
Like it or not.
Like it or not.
Paul?
Yes?
Can I make a comment that?
Yes, please.
It was actually voted by the people.
Exactly, it was, for last year.
No, the way it's worded, it was to, beginning the fiscal year on a regular basis.
Then why were we, why did we even discuss it?
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Well, we don't have a policy, we had to go through that.
Right.
Okay.
We didn't have a policy now, and that's.
Yeah, I mean, that's, okay. So we don't need to vote on it? No, we do.
I make a motion, we approve the 1500 for longevity.
Second. Second. All those in favor?
Well, I can't say 1500, is that what you were going to say? Actually, it should have been just longevity, should have put a month.
Yeah, because I don't.
It's going to change.
It's 1500, so.
All right, I got to rescind that then. I make a motion, we approve longevity. Hey, I don't know.
Love longevity.
I don't like it. On a regular basis.
Until the personnel policy is
changes.
Get them together.
But we support personnel policy. It's fine.
We're all in favor.
We're just not putting the money.
We're all in favor.
We're all in favor. We're not putting the money value.
Okay. Who's, did you second that? So I have a few unanticipated items that I'd like to go over with you quickly, and then if you want to spend some time, if you have any questions on any of the expenditures, I'd like to go over the budget sheet with you also to look at revenues and things like that. But real quickly, let me just pass out a few updates. Here is an update from Wendy at the libraries, at the library, regarding programs and activities for 2015. This is a detailed sheet that you guys asked for last week.
Yeah.
To justify the increase in hours for the library director and assistant library director.
Well, she's been busy. Wow.
Yeah, there's a lot of programs out there.
Almost 1,500 people attended.
Well done, Wendy.
Wendy, nice job. Thank you.
I also have a request for a reserve fund transfer for $1.
Yeah, I'll give you $1.
This was just
I tried that already, Tommy.
Oh, my God. The amount of paperwork you've got to generate?
It's just a rounding error. It was a rounding error, so.
This is what we should fund.
Frontier Regional Transportation.
So if you want to jump back to page 3 in your budget books. And I realize you haven't had a chance to look this over, and maybe you want to wait until the next meeting to do that. But if there's anything in here that jumps out at you now and you want to talk about it, we can, or we can talk about a date for the for the next meeting and go over it then. I mean, this is going to be updated slightly anyway at the next meeting, so.
I think we should just, we'll sort of digest this.
On the revenue side. Anything out of free cash?
Yes.
Good.
Okay, so.
Okay, I see.
Yep, on five, the bottom, near the bottom, 5B. So what I did here, now this number is going to change because of the fire emissions. This was assuming that you funded all capital items, including the emissions. And what I did here was budgeted in here $130,489. That's all of the capital items minus the dump truck, because that's included in short-term debt in a different section.
Okay.
And then I was recommending that you offset taxation by $200,000 in free cash.
Okay.
Which is significantly higher than last year.
Yeah.
I think we did 125 total, and that included capital. So it wasn't much.
Right.
But you have it this year, so.
Yes.
And
but
that
still gets the rate down.
That would still leave you with a balance of $200,000.
In free cash, that's.
You okay with that, Tom?
Yeah, I am.
You're a free cash guy, so.
He likes the cash.
Yeah, I like having cash, but I mean, we could use
another
50 of it. If, I don't know how much it would reduce the tax rate. That's my
question. Well, I mean, are you comfortable with the 200,000
left
over there?
And I just want to, it's 330,489 total with those two. Well, actually, that will be, like I said, be adjusted now.
What,
330,489?
330,489.
Capital,
yeah, I put a little note on the side there what that number was. Capital plus free cash offset taxation. And I just want to remind you guys, as you look over the expenditure sheets from FY15, that any of those budgets that you're looking at that have unspent money, this is where we get our free cash from, something.
Yeah.
I mean,
sure.
So, you know, I don't want to see you spend too much, you know, it's
you can cut them all down now, but in the end it's going to come to you're going to lose money.
It's short-sighted if you,
yeah,
if you budget that way.
Well, it's so common to have placeholders, you know, regardless of whether you're spending or not. You need a placeholder in there for
right.
A lot of expenses. It's just that we need to know if that's zero.
Yeah,
or
no, I just wanted to suggest,
yeah,
that you didn't use it as a way to cut back budgets, because
no, I
have,
and that's what I sent out this last
week.
I agree. I mean, that's,
yeah, plus people will spend the money,
right? You're going to force them to spend everything that they have,
but we're not going to do someone else's job. This is it's if someone else has a responsibility to track dollars and spend dollars in certain ways and will not report it, don't expect us to say okay.
No, but you know that
I mean, that's
to defend some of the departments, that they're volunteer boards and committees also that,
yeah, so
are spending a lot of time and energy and,
yeah,
you know.
I get you.
And we certainly need all of our volunteer.
Yeah, we're not going to ask them for stamp receipts. You know, I mean, we're not going
to
do that, but you tell,
we
but
just
tell
need
me
to
if
know.
You need it. In black and white. And that's why I was asking about the software. Is there a way that we could, you know, eliminate that burden from them having to do it by having software that did it automatically? I mean, I think that would be.
It's not impossible to do it even under the system we have. It's just, I mean, I'll just show you, this is one, this is town buildings here. So in order for me to do the expenditures, I have to go through all these pages of expenditures.
So links that you don't have to, it will summarize it for you. But
no,
it's not set up that
no,
way.
No. It will give you your bottom line for town buildings, but you have to go through and summarize it.
Right, we're doing that
manually.
So, no, I mean, it is. I mean, this is a, you know, if we don't have the ability to do it, I understand it's crazy to go through every line item like that and add things up. I mean,
it's
it's not impossible to do, but there's, you know, I mean, we're gonna take salary paid people to go adding this stuff up. I mean, it's not a good use of resources.
That's what we do. I had to go a lot.
And I understand that, but it's, you know, it would be great. I mean, I have a budget that I manage, and every Friday it comes out and it tells me, here's the detailed budget, here's the summarized budget. I flush the detailed one and I just look at the summary.
We get, you
know, it's not a bottom line, it's a per line item. You know, tell me where I guarantee
that there are private concerns right around here who could fix that for us in a heartbeat, that know what kind of software would do what, that would, this is, you know, 2016, moving into 2017.
But we're still using
companies software. Don't do that.
The companies don't, but we're in a group a group software. So unless that group wants to go out there and purchase new software.
And what would it cost you for that software?
Right. So I mean, it's not Whately software.
It might, I don't know. But if you don't look, you'll never find out.
They average about $30,000.
Remember, if you do what you've done, you're gonna get what you got. And what we have doesn't work so good. So that's why we need to kind of take a look at it a little closer.
Well, it works good for other purposes, reporting, and I mean, you can't just look at it as one function. This offers reports that need to be submitted to the state, and there's a whole bunch of other functions of this software other than just calculating the budget for individual parties. And I think we might be a little bit confused. I mean, I get a treasurer collector bottom line. This is how much I've spent, this is how much I have left every 2 weeks on my on any of our budgets. However, we don't get 500 of that went to postage, right. 500 of that went to something else. So it gives you some information, but not as detailed as you may wish to see.
And Blake, can you repeat what you said? I don't think anybody heard that the cost for software averages.
About $30,000.
What?
Even our local city and town that we had a few years ago was, and this was, has to be 10 years ago now, was 15, and that's one of those hybrids that was developed locally. But again, it didn't have the reporting functions. It did really well on budgeting, but was not really good on other parts. And it also came with the town accountant. So once we lost that town accountant, we had to change to a different software.
It's a matter of being fiscally responsible from our perspective. And you haven't done it in a while. It's just something we need to remind you that get closer to doing that year after year. I mean, and we can't expect you to spend $30,000 in one fell swoop, but maybe there are small ways that this can be accomplished over time. Because I just don't feel, I'm with Jim and most of them, I just don't feel like I have enough information other than the verbal word, which is fine, but it's not comparing expenses, what we did expend, what you're requesting, and that whole piece is really.
So who puts that all together? Our 30 committees each get a computer with the software? How does this work?
Each get a sheet, a budget sheet that they have to fill out.
Right, but now where does the software come in?
I don't know.
But there really is
none. There is none.
It's just an Excel spreadsheet.
Right? I understand, but who's going to put it on it?
The department heads.
Yeah, but he's talking about 30 little committees here that don't have what they want.
Yeah, right, we have.
So where do they get their computer work?
They're doing it manually from their manual.
Well, I understand. Records. So, but software and manual, I'm missing the correlation here. The software, do you want them to do it? Or?
The accountant would have the software is what you're getting at.
Yeah,
he would provide those reports back to us.
Right. And they print out the detailed report, and then the same as Keith and I or any of us, they would sit down and say, okay, how much did I spend on postage? Add up all the postage receipts that you have. How much did I spend on electricity? Add up all the electricity sheets you have, receipts you have.
And our system can't do that now.
It can if we did it by.
Keith does it.
I have to do it manually.
Yeah, we all do it manually.
Well, that's what I'm missing. I'm missing the manual. He's entering it manually into the computer.
If his budget
two separate systems.
If his budget was broken down, winter roads.
If we had a line item budget, like Keith's budget, winter roads, okay, he has salary, he has, and we voted it that way so that the accountant would keep track of every one of those individual lines. Which it's capable of doing, it's just we've never, it's never been done that way. Not that it can't be, I don't want to be one of those people that says it can't be. But because, and then if it's by line, if we vote a budget by line, then each department has to keep within those line items. So like Keith was explaining, if he, his winter roads was a little, his plow blade section of the winter roads budget was a little tight and he wanted to buy a plow blade, he would actually have to go back to the finance committee, ask for a reserve fund transfer from one of his other funds into
that account.
No.
You
do not want that.
So.
You lost me. I'm just.
What we want is expenditures.
Transparency.
Filled in from the year before. So what we have is we have a number of smaller committees, groups, etc., who have never filled in what they expensed. Now, some could be $500, some's $300, but I said when you add it all up, it's $58,000 that has no backing. And I think we got to whittle that down. We got to sort of get to a point where.
Well, it's not even whittle this, and I don't mean to jump in. I don't think he's saying whittle it down, the budget down.
No.
Whittle down the number that we're not getting something to match it with.
Exactly.
I mean, that's really what it comes down to. I don't think we're looking at that. We have a $60,000 savings out there anyway.
It's just that
somebody that has a $3,000 budget that historically has been spending $1,000.
It's looking at a budget and trying to decide for ourselves whether an increase in a particular line item is justified as warranted. How does the person preparing the budget know this if they don't know what they spent on in the past? All that we get in these meetings is the highlights.
I get it, and that's why.
But you're one of the biggest.
It's clear to me, like an example, street sweeping. There's been years where the previous number that you saw is more than what was budgeted that year. And so the next year I come in and I ask for more money and you can say, okay, you spent, we see that you spent that much last year and it's and you feel that it's justified. I can see that and I understand that. But yet, what we're trying to tell you is I have to do that all manually.
Right. Well, the perfect example of this thing is, you know, where we turn over the recreation committee.
Yeah.
I mean, we turn over that person in charge of it every 2 or 3 years. And so Jonathan comes in here, I don't know when he stepped in, he doesn't have a clue as to what
is historically was being done. I understand that.
That's
a hard,
I wouldn't say the bigger problem, because
that's
I don't think any of it's really a problem, but he couldn't sit there and say, this is how much we spent last year, or whatever it was.
Rex expenditures, and Jonathan had only been on Rec for about 25 days when that fiscal year closed. So it was a real challenge, but we went through it and we broke it down as best we could. The bottom line is on. It's just we had to.
But I guess my point is that we've turned that, I mean, there's been, since I've been here, three or four that have that have run that group. And so it's difficult to come in, you know.
But I think now after these updates, that $58,000 to $60,000 figure that you were quoting is probably down to $1,500 to $2,000. So, and those will come in.
We'll
just
cry about them.
We just need to. I'll probably give them to you now.
Maybe another way of looking at it is if the memo goes out to everybody when they turn in an invoice, sort of keep a tab, so to speak, of as to
what you think.
Where it was
your own spreadsheet.
On your own spreadsheet type thing, and then when the end of the year's
do, you already have that, and you don't have to go back and try to recreate it.
Exactly.
So.
You know, not to pick on a specific budget, but here's Tri-Town Beach, and you know, FY14 appropriated, Whately's share of it was $4,252.70, and then under FY14 expended, it's all blanks. There's not even what they spent. Never mind each line item. All I want to know is what they spent. Every one of those is blank. But every year they want an increase. So,
yeah.
So, you know, and I mean, that's probably one of the three that hasn't.
They actually haven't voted on their budget yet. They're maybe getting next week to vote on their budget.
You know, I mean, but you got to have some idea of how much money they spend. And I understand what they don't spend goes into free cash, which is our savings account, so to speak. But, you know, you got to have some idea of how much they spend.
You know, it's kind of like the town is a bank.
Yeah.
And all these committees are, and departments are areas that we invest in. And it helps us out. Now think of a bank, a real bank. Could you go into a real bank and try to get a loan for a business and not show them what you're going to expense, and you just went in and said, I want the money. Life doesn't work that way.
It does for the water swim hole.
Yeah, it does for Tri-Town Beach.
It does for Tri-Town Beach.
Some of these other, you know, planning boards, some of these other smaller committees with a conservation commission with a $500 budget.
Oh, my God.
Mark, does the state have any requirements as far as a ceiling on what our free cash could be?
Not that I know of.
They have a stabilization that they have the recommendations, but free cash.
So
they would question if you had a huge free cash because they'd say, why are you taxing your residents so high if you really didn't need that money?
Right.
I mean, if you got some kind of influx of money, and there was a reason behind it, say you sold a piece of property or something like that, then you've got an explanation why that free cash is so high.
But it was particularly high this year.
This was an anomaly this year.
Yeah.
I've never seen it that high.
We didn't sell any property or anything, so what? No, was it just over budgeting?
We had some other things going on.
We closed out a lot of accounts.
Yeah.
What about new growth?
There was new growth, but that doesn't.
We use a number for that, but the excess does show up in free cash.
You know, it's just on this subject, revenues, the cell tower, because you mentioned free cash and selling off land. I was under the assumption in this that we stayed with the status quo, which is about $45,000 a year in revenue. So if we decide to do the 10-year plan with the cell tower, that revenue figure will triple, a little bit more than triple. So
that's
again,
something
we'll talk about
deal
that later,
with,
but
yes.
I just I didn't want
cash?
What's that?
Is that free cash?
Or in a roundabout way, it'll get back into free cash.
But it's not listed as free cash, it's listed as
the money we make from the cell tower now is listed as revenue in local receipts.
I don't think we should mix those.
They get mixed.
It gets mixed in the long run because your revenues are part of what makes your free cash.
Right.
So.
What I'm saying is I didn't.
True free cash is basically your fund balance after you've spent, after last year's money and spent all your expenses, paid all your expenses. So that's a different number than getting rent from the cell tower.
Well, if you got $1 million for the cell tower by selling it, that revenue will, at the end of the year, it's going to say, well, you have all this extra revenue that you didn't use. It will flow and become free cash.
two-thirds when it's certified. What I was trying to get at here is this tax rate is conservative. It's not, I didn't inflate revenues based on the cell tower, so.
Have you, do we have a date for the meeting to, with the select board to talk about the tower?
Not yet.
Okay, so we're on for next Tuesday?
We are on for next Tuesday.
Six o'clock? Do next Tuesday at 6 o'clock?
Sure.
Is that okay?
All right, we gotta be here anyway.
Have we discussed senior center expense? Have we discussed it in our allocation and?
No, you have an assessment in there.
I know we have an assessment, but who oversees that budget?
Deerfield.
Because it went up quite a bit.
Six o'clock, I'm getting nine. Yep. I'll send an agenda in the minutes of this meeting tomorrow.
So, what was the increase?
Well, salaries increased 16+%
Excellent. 16%?
Yeah.
Salaries?
Director's salaries.
Really? What page is it?
33.
There's a new hire.
Yeah, they have a new director.
Program assistant went up 6%.
They add a day of her time at the senior center.
They may have added, did they add some administrative time or something like that?
There's also discussion that they're going to come to the towns for CPA funds to help renovate the building.
Renovate the building?
Yeah, can move, if Skems doesn't move, anyone put him right, can they get, how's he?
Yeah, there was a salary adjustment for the director, but you can see that salaries on the low end anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, you can hopefully understand that they had to negotiate a better salary than 27 or something.
Yeah.
Okay, any other thoughts? Do I have a motion to adjourn?
A motion we adjourn.
Second?
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
See you next week.